Let's talk about sugar for a minute. And I hear you, everybody talks about sugar. I talk about sugar. I've done plenty of videos on sugar explaining what sugar is and where you find it and how to avoid it. But I recently saw some numbers and it just struck me that when you understand sugar by the numbers, it can make such a difference in the way you actually view it, that I just want to share some numbers with you. So welcome to Shape Fixer, or welcome back to Shape Fixer for those of you who have been here before. And in this video, I'm going to break down some numbers. Now, the first thing is, let's talk about blood sugar, which is glucose, okay? There are different types of sugar, but the sugar that is measured when you have a blood sugar test is glucose. And your body does require a small amount of glucose in your blood. Your brain will send signals to the liver to control that glucose level and make sure that you have around 4.5 to 5 grams of glucose in your blood at any one time, because your brain uses it for some of its essential functions. Now, 5 grams is a teaspoon. It's a flat teaspoon of glucose. That is through your entire body, 4.5 to 5 liters of blood. So you've got something like 100 milligrams per deciliter, or let's say a gram for each liter of blood. It's really very low amount. But if you drop below that amount, your brain sends emergency signals to your body to start shutting certain functions down, including unnecessary muscle movements. And so an athlete, for example, doing a marathon will experience fatigue and be forced to slow down by the brain stopping their muscles working when their blood glucose goes below 4 or 5 grams. So now, when you get a blood test and you have a fasting glucose test, it's usually around about 90 to 100. And what does that actually mean? Well, that does translate to 1 gram per liter of blood. So if it's around 90 or 100, it means you have 4.5 to 5 milligrams grams of of sugar in your blood. So that is the correct level, and doctors know this, and that is a way to monitor your blood sugar state and give you an early sign of any kind of diabetes problems. What happens when we do get too much? Immediately, the red lights come on and your liver has to take it out of the blood in some way, because sugar in the blood is actually bad for you. Even the 4 or 5 grams that you're supposed to have does some damage. So sugar molecules are sticky. They will stick to proteins. They will stick to your red blood cells. They will stick to your artery walls. We call this glycation, and it disrupts the functioning of the proteins and does damage. But having 4 to 5 grams of sugar in your blood is so important to your brain that that outweighs the small amount of damage that 4 or 5 grams will do, and your body will continually have to keep repairing that low level of damage. But if your blood sugar goes above that, all that extra sugar is just doing damage for no benefit. That your body cannot abide, and so your body has systems in place to pull that blood sugar down again and to basically just get the hell rid of it somehow. So the first thing that happens when your blood sugar does go up is your liver releases insulin into your blood, and insulin herds or shepherds glucose molecules into the cells, get them out of the blood, get them into the cells, into the mitochondria, so the cells can burn them. And then we say, oh, good, look, it's doing this so that we have energy, so we can burn the sugar for energy. Fine. Your cells can only accept so much. If the cells are full and they just say to the, no, sorry, we can't accept any more sugar, there's a panic. So your insulin level goes up even more to force sugar, to pack it into the cells. And so there's this race between the cells saying, for heaven's sake, we've got too much glucose here, and your insulin level getting higher and higher. And at a point, it doesn't work properly anymore. So your liver goes, okay, hang on, bring me the extra glucose. I'll turn it into glycogen, which is a sugar store. We'll pack that in the muscles, ready for burning when the cells have capacity. And if it goes even higher than that, then excess glucose, because now you can't even fit glycogen anywhere, you end up making body fat. So we understand the mechanism for getting fat. That's too much glucose. Your body can't process it. It has to come out of the blood because it is toxic. It will kill you. It is very, very dangerous to have high blood sugar. And so it becomes body fat. Okay, fine. What increases our blood sugar so much? Why do we go above 5 grams of sugar? Well, you could start by eating a banana. And a banana sounds like a pretty harmless thing to do. But you eat a banana, you get 10 grams of sugar, of glucose. So all of a sudden, from having 5 grams in your blood, you've got 15. That's 3 times. That's already way too much, and you're starting to do damage, and your body has to do something. So your insulin level goes up. If you have a glass of orange juice, you're going to get about 40 grams of sugar. So now you've gone from 5 grams to 45 grams. That is 900% increase in your blood sugar. It is very dangerous. A candy bar is 50 grams, which isn't really that much more than a glass of orange juice. So it doesn't take much for you to push your, potentially push your blood glucose level to very dangerous levels. And so your body has to be very good at producing insulin, ramping up the insulin level very quickly to process all this toxic sugar out. But you could say, well, then, okay, so what's the problem with that? The problem with that is that insulin is involved in something like 100 processes in your body, not just taking, clearing sugar out of your blood and storing fat. Insulin is involved in a lot of things, and very high, consistently high, artificially high, stimulated insulin levels lead to all sorts of problems. Insulin resistance, which is pre-diabetes, diabetes, heart disease, various inflammatory problems, all as a result of regularly over-exciting the production of insulin. And it's called hyperinsulinemia. It leads to metabolic disease and fatty liver disease and all sorts of things like that. So you really don't want to be constantly spiking your insulin. And the only reason you're doing that is because you're eating carbohydrates and making the sugar level in your blood toxic. Now, you can say, and we did, like, oh, but you need it for the energy because the sugar goes to the cells and gets burned for energy. Does it though? Does it go there so that it can produce energy? Or does it go there because your body's trying to get rid of it? It's a waste disposal system. It's getting rid of what is essentially toxic in your blood. Think of it as an incineration system for the garbage disposal. The fact that you do generate energy in the process of getting rid of this toxic sugar, well, that's a bonus. That's quite useful, I guess. But it's not necessary, because if you don't have waste toxic sugar to burn, your body will calm down, your insulin levels will stay where they should be, and you will just burn fat, because that's what it's for. And we have fat in our diet, and it burns without any problem, without raising insulin, so you don't have blood sugar. It doesn't affect your blood sugar at all. And you don't have these massive energy spikes and then energy drops where you feel absolutely flat and exhausted and have to force feed yourself with more energy food. So it works much better. Now, we call this ketosis. Burning fat is ketosis. It's using fat for energy. Lions are in ketosis all the time because what do they eat? Meat. They don't eat carbohydrates. They don't eat any sugar at all. And they operate just fine burning the fat from the meat that they eat. So they're in ketosis. But what about a cow, for example? Cows don't eat meat. They don't eat fat. So what do? Here's a funny thing. Cows are also in ketosis because cows eat grass, a lot of grass, but they can't digest it. It's full of cellulose. They cannot digest cellulose any more than we can. But their microbes in their gut can. They have special microbes in their gut. They have a different gut environment or microbiome to us. And those microbes will live off the grass, the cellulose in the grass, and break it down and give off, guess what? Protein and fat. And that is what the cows then absorb, and they live off the protein and fat produced by their gut microbes. So cows are in ketosis. Cows are using fat as their energy source, not sugar. It's really interesting. Or people will say, oh, but you know, you're missing the point here, because if you take your sugar, and let's use the banana and the fruit juice, well, at least the banana as the example, and I was talking about the amount of sugar that's in a banana, and people will say, yes, but fruit's different because fruit contains fiber, and fiber is fantastic because it blocks the absorption of the sugar, or at least slows down the absorption of the sugar. Therefore, fruit is good for you. Now, hang on a minute. So you're saying eat fruit because it's full of sugar, and we're acknowledging that sugar is bad for you, but fruit also has fiber that slows down the absorption of that toxic sugar. Therefore, fruit is good for you. No, you don't need to slow down the absorption of the sugar if you don't eat the sugar. Just don't eat it. Then it doesn't matter. And fiber has no other purpose in any case. That's already been proved. And I've done a video on fiber. I'll link it down here. You don't need fiber. The only thing we might need fiber for in our modern diet is exactly to try to limit or slow the absorption of all the sugars we eat, because we have such a carbohydrate heavy diet. If you don't eat all that crap, you won't need fiber either. So that's not true. And then the other argument I hear in favor of sugars in certain forms is that they're natural. So we hear this a lot about fructose, which is otherwise known as fruit sugar. Oh, fructose. Fructose is different. It's not glucose. That's what you get in fruit, and it's completely different, and it's natural sugar. Well, firstly, fructose cannot be used by your body, so it goes to the liver, and the liver converts it to glucose, and then it goes into your bloodstream. And there you go, hey presto, fructose becomes glucose. So that doesn't really fly. But yes, it's natural because it's in fruit. Table sugar or sucrose, it also comes from plants. Sugar cane or sugar beets, that's natural. In fact, all sugar is natural. All sugars are made by plants. That's where sugars come from. They're made by plants. They're all as natural as each other. The sugar in honey is still sugar. It's still a lot of fructose and sucrose. It's exactly the same thing. They're all natural. Natural doesn't make it good for you. I can think of lots of toxic plants in my garden that I can't eat. They're natural. Cyanide and arsenic are natural. So that's a non-argument, the fact that sugar is natural. Of course it's natural, and it's not good for you. So why do we eat so much of it? It's addictive. It's addictive. You get a dopamine hit from sugar, and the dopamine hit from fructose is especially strong. It's like 7 times as bad as glucose. So when you eat fruit or processed foods with fructose corn syrup in them, you get a really big dopamine hit, which is a spike of dopamine, which is your hormone that makes you feel good and feel like you've accomplished something and really pleased with yourself. It's a motivation hormone, and you get a dopamine hit. So it's fun. And the more used to it you get, the less dopamine is released. And so the more of it you have to have. Alcohol follows a similar path, and so do amphetamines. A lot of illegal drugs also operate on this basis, and that's why you get addicted to them, and you have to have more and more and more to be able to get the effect. So the more sugar you eat, the more sugar you want to eat. Now, sugar appeals to us. So does salty fat. But the difference is that when you have an urge to eat something salty or something fatty, the more you eat, the less you want, until you're full and you're not interested anymore and you lose the desire to eat it, because it is a natural self-limiting system where your hormones that you produce when you do eat salty fat increase to the point where they stop you wanting any more, and that controls your eating, and so you have reached satiety and you just lose interest and you don't want to eat anymore. You eat more sugar, it promotes hormones that want you to eat yet more and yet more and yet more. When you eat salty fat, you produce a hormone that makes you stop. And so it's a self-limiting system. So you don't get fat eating a diet of fat. You get fat eating a diet of carbohydrates, which are sugar, which boost your blood glucose, boost your insulin, make you store fat, and stop you actually burning off the excess fat that you've got. Because when your insulin is continuously high, you can't access the fat. And all this comes back to the point that your blood needs to have 4 to 5 grams of glucose in it at any time. And the longer you can keep it at that basic level, the healthier you are going to be and the more efficient your metabolic processes are going to be to keep you healthy, to stop you getting sick, and to stop you getting fat. You can double, triple, multiply by 10 times your glucose level very easily by just having a sandwich or a plate of pasta. So it's very, very easy to get your blood sugar up to a toxic level, and it makes you sick. Okay, please share this with people who you think might want to understand the actual numbers, not just the theory that sugar is bad for you and sugar makes you fat, the actual numbers and how easy it is to get your sugar level too high. Thank you for your time. Please subscribe to our channel, and we'll see you back here for the next video.